Greetings and good evening to all of you from Christian Medical College, Vellore, and the COVID Command Center Training Desk. While we are observing a decreasing trend in the second wave, the challenges still continue. And one of the challenges what we are all facing is the emergence of mucormycosis in such patients. Here at CMC, we are blessed to have a multidisciplinary team who's managing this mucormycosis amongst our patients. And this is a clinical team of ENT surgeons supported by our ophthalmologists, the medical team of infectious disease specialists, and also our nursing team who are playing a role in the clinical management. This approach would be incomplete without an active and essential support by a strong and dedicated team of radiologists, microbiologists, and pathologists. Due to the limitation of time of 1 hour for this kind of a session, we are bringing this session on mucormycosis in two parts. And today, the part one session, you'll be able to listen to the experience from a clinical team. And the part two of the session will be brought to you a day after, that is on 9th of June, Wednesday, 4 to 5 p.m., where a diagnostic team of radiologists, microbiologists, and pathologists will be sharing their expertise. And as we begin this session, and while we still grapple with this pandemic and various kinds of stress which our healthcare workers go through, I would like to share a short prayer by our founder, Dr. Ida Scudder, which she often said whenever she felt overwhelmed physically, emotionally, and mentally to gain strength from the Almighty. Father, whose life is within me and whose love is ever about me, grant that thy life may be maintained in my life today and every day. That with gladness of heart, without haste or confusion of thought, I may go about my daily tasks, conscious of ability to meet every rightful demand. Seeing the larger meaning of little things and finding beauty and love everywhere and in the sense of thy presence, may I walk through the hours, breathing the atmosphere of love rather than anxious striving. Amen. I would now like to invite Dr. Rupa Vedantam, a senior professor in the department of CMC at ENT department. I'm sure ma'am has seen this presentation in a different context. So over to Dr. Rupa to take over this session.
Thank you, Thomas. Am I heard? Yes. Good afternoon, everyone. I invite you all to this hour-long session on various lectures on several aspects of mucormycosis, a problem that we are really grappling with. The topic of mucormycosis has evinced a lot of interest during both the first and the second waves of this pandemic, both among the lay public as well as the medical fraternity. This is because largely because of the surge in cases through both the waves of the pandemic, more through the second wave than the first wave. During the, in ordinary times, we would see about 25 to 30 cases of mucormycosis a year. Now, this is from a single institution and across India, these are large numbers. But during the first wave of the pandemic, in 1 month alone, we saw almost double the number. And during the second wave, we are seeing 4 to 5 times this number. So it is a big problem that we are grappling with. Now, while we've been managing patients of acute invasive fungal sinusitis for several years, really, in CMC, it was only about 2014 or so that we managed to slowly put together a multidisciplinary team to handle these cases. Now, as Dr. Thomas already mentioned, it's really important that you have a multidisciplinary team to handle these cases. And so we got together a representation from the rhinology unit of the Department of ENT, infectious diseases department, medicine department, ophthalmology, microbiology, pathology, hematology, and dental departments. And we've had, you know, numerous discussions and CME programs, and constantly refined our diagnostic and therapeutic protocols in the management of these patients. So when this epidemic within the pandemic appeared on us, we were, you could say, quite prepared to handle the situation. Well, that is what we thought. So in the first wave of the pandemic, the rhinology unit, and with all the supportive departments, kind of managed most of the cases. But during the second wave of the pandemic, it was altogether too overwhelming. Our doctors were going to the going for emergency cases through the day and night. And this is when the entire Department of ENT rallied along and helped the doctors in the rhinology unit. And we have now very nicely planned out surgical teams, pre-op care teams, post-op care teams. And I have to say that it is being managed quite well. Now, as there's a lot of ground to cover, I will stop here. And before I invite the first speaker, I would just like to say a few words about the questions that might be come up as these presentations are made. For this audience, I would say, please put in your questions into the chat box, and most of the time the speakers will answer them right away. For the speakers, I would say, please try to answer all the relevant questions, and any questions that just don't remain unanswered, we will deal with at the end of all the sessions. So I will stop here, and I will invite our first speaker, Dr. Lali Verghese, to make her presentation. Dr. Lali is professor of ENT in the rhinology unit at CMC. She's been very actively and enthusiastically involved in the management of these patients in both the first and the second waves. And I am sure she will have a lot of interesting things to share. Dr. Lali, please go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening, everybody. At the outset, I would like to thank the COVID Command Center Training Desk, Christian Medical College, for giving me this opportunity to talk about the clinical presentation and evaluation of mucormycosis. So fungal sinusitis is broadly classified into invasive and non-invasive forms. Among the invasive form, the acute invasive fungal sinusitis is most commonly seen in immunocompromised and immunosuppressed individuals. And the disease is known for its rapid progression, leading to mortality in around 30 to 80% of the patients. If you look at the fungi which cause the infection, they belong to two groups. The mucorales, under which comes the rhizopus, rhizomucor, mucor, cunningamella, et cetera, and the aspergillus, under which comes the fumigators, flavus, and the niger species. So when an acute invasive fungal sinusitis is caused by the fungi belonging to the order mucorales, we call it mucormycosis. This is the entity which has come into spotlight in a big way during this surge of the COVID pandemic. However, mucorales are saprophytes which are found everywhere. It's found in the soil, in the dust, and we're inhaling it all the time. But most of the time, these opportunistic organisms live without a sequelae. However, if somebody is under immunosuppression, the spores tend to germinate, rapidly proliferate, and invade the sinonasal mucosa and spread beyond. So who all are at risk of developing a mucormycosis? Mostly, these are people who have impaired neutrophilic function, as in uncontrolled diabetes, especially if they are in ketoacidosis, hematological malignancy patients, aplastic anemia, severe neutropenia, hemochromatosis, or HIV infection. Yet another subgroup are those under iatrogenic immunosuppression, like in patients who have undergone a bone marrow or solid organ transplant, who are on prolonged corticosteroid therapy, currently on chemotherapy. And a new addition to this high-risk group of patients are the COVID positive or patients who have recently recovered from a COVID infection. So how do they present? So for that, we need to know where does the infection happen. Most commonly, mucormycosis occurs in the maxillary sinus, the ethmoid sinus, and the sphenoid sinus in the descending order. From the maxillary sinus, if the infection spreads anteriorly or laterally, it can involve the cheek and the skin. Posterior extension can involve the pterygopalatine fossa and the infratemporal fossa. Superiorly, if it goes beyond the sinus, it could involve the orbit, and inferior extension can involve the palate and the alveolus. If it's the ethmoid sinus, superiorly, it can go across the skull base to involve the anteriocranial fossa. Laterally, it can go across the thin plate of bone, the lamina papyracea, and extend onto the orbit. Medial extension can involve the cribriform plate and the nasal septum. The posterior most sinus sphenoid, if it's an iris of infection, there are a lot of structures related to it laterally. In the cavernous sinus, we have the internal carotid artery, the third, fourth, and sixth cranial nerves, and the upper two divisions of the trigeminal nerve. So our patient can come to us with multiple symptoms. They may come with fever with spike, which is not responding to antibiotic. Even though the infection arises from the nose, the nasal symptoms are usually very subtle and very non-specific. They may or may not have nasal obstruction. If nasal discharge is present, it could be blood-stained or serosanguinous. One of the early symptoms could be a loss of sensation over the face or oral cavity. I would say if somebody picks this up, this is very early stage, which precedes the development of subsequent symptoms. The common facial symptoms are facial pain, facial swelling. This is seen in more than 50% of the patients with mucormycosis. There could be loss of sensation over the cheek, and in advanced cases, it can spread onto the cheek, forming eschar like this. The oromaxillary symptoms could be dental pain, loosening of the tooth, palatal bulge, or it could be discoloration of the palate, where it could be like a pale mucosa or discolored dusky mucosa, which can progress on to become ulcer or crust formation later. The orbital symptoms again could be very subtle. It could just be a lid edema or periorbital swelling, which may further progress on to conjunctival congestion, chemosis, or proptosis. Some patients come straight with ptosis or restricted or absent eye movements, and in later stages with complete or partial loss of vision. The common cranial nerve which could get affected are the second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and the seventh. If the patient has an altered sensorium or a delirium, convulsions, hemiparesis, hemiplegia, or coma, you should always think about the intracranial extension. So depending on this, mucormycosis could be classified into three. In the stage one, the disease is confined to the nose and paranasal sinuses. In stage two, the disease extends beyond the nose and paranasal sinuses, but it's still fully resectable, as in the anterior orbit, subcutaneous tissue, pterygopalatine fossa, or the palate. In stage three disease, there is the extra paranasal sinus spread, which is unresectable. This could be intracranial, deep skull base, or orbital apex involvement. So somebody in the high-risk category, if they come with any of these symptoms, we need to do a complete ENT examination, giving particular care to the eye and oral examination. If there are any eye symptoms, we need to get an ophthalmology opinion. And if there is any suspicion of an intracranial spread, we need to involve the neurosurgery team also. After that, we go on to our routine blood investigations, which could include a complete blood count, random blood sugar and HbA1c to know the glycemic control status of the patient, serum creatinine, electrolytes. The radiological investigation of choice would be a CT paranasal sinus with contrast. However, if we are seeing or suspecting an orbital, soft tissue, or intracranial involvement, a MRI and CT scan of the base of skull with gadolinium would be a better investigation. Then we proceed on with the diagnostic nasal endoscopy. Here we look for altered nasal mucosa. The areas we focus are usually the middle turbinate, the middle meatus, septum, and the inferior turbinate. It would be evident as a decreased nasal sensation or decreased mucosal bleeding. The mucosa may be pale, dusky, or black. Occasionally, we come across granulations, ulcerations, and in late stages, eschar formation. So in this picture, we can see the mucosa is pale, and here it has gone on to the necrotic stage and a blackish crust on the middle turbinate. And this is a late stage disease with the whole nose completely covered by eschar. During the nasal endoscopy, we also try and obtain sample for biopsy and urgent fungal smear and culture. If the facilities are available, it's always advisable to send for a frozen section analysis so that we get an urgent report and the treatment can be started immediately. Where to take the biopsy from? If the diseased mucosa is evident, we should always take sample from there. But if the nasal mucosa is appearing normal, it's advisable to take the sample from the middle turbinate. This is because in almost 67% of patients with acute invasive fungal sinusitis, there is middle turbinate involvement. Of late, we are seeing that even though the fungal smear is positive, the fungal culture may be negative in a proportion of patients. So what do we see in the smear? The KOH wet mount, the fungal hyphae may be seen as broad, aseptate, ribbon-like, and irregular. This is much better seen in the calcifer staining. On Sabrod's agar, the fungi grow as they are rapidly growing as a loose white mold. And with formation of sporangia, since the spores are dark in color, the colony turns dark gray in color. Histopathology is confirmative of the diagnosis. Evidence of these broad aseptate fungal hyphae within the sinus mucosa, submucosa, blood vessels of bone is confirmatory of mucormycosis. This could be accompanied with neutrophilic inflammation. However, this finding may be absent in severely immunosuppressed individuals. In later stages, angioinvasion, perineural infusion, and infarcts may be visible. Here in the first picture, we can see the broad aseptate fungal hyphae seen within the tissue. However, if you're using the fungal stains like the silver, the gomery methanamin silver stain, the hyphae are better demonstrated. Now we have reached a diagnosis, we go on to look at the extent of the disease. The CT scan, the findings may be very subtle in the initial stages. It may be very non-specific, like a unilateral mucosal thickening, which is hypoattenuating. This can progress on to become opacification of the sinus. The extraparanasal spread of the disease is evidenced by fat stranding, that is the loss of fat plane around the sinus. This is commonly seen in the premaxillary area, pterygopalatine fossa, orbit, and the masticator space. Bone destruction. In the early stages, even if there is an extraparanasal sinus spread, there may not be any bone destruction because the disease spreads along the vessels and the nerves. However, in very advanced disease, severe bone destruction may be visible also. So here we can see the right maxillary sinus. There is a mucosal thickening and there is loss of fat plane in the premaxillary, the retromaxillary areas, and within the orbit. So CT imaging do not correlate well with surgical and pathological findings. In one of our CTs, almost 13% of patients who had normal CT findings had a pathological disease within the sinus. So the CT scan serves as a roadmap to the surgeon defining the bony architecture. Like I said earlier, when there is a soft tissue abnormality, intracranial or intraorbital extension or a cavernous sinus thrombosis, it is imperative to do a gadolinium-enhanced MRA scan of the paranasal sinus and brain. In T1 weighted images, the lesion may be seen as iso or hypointense. In T2 weighted, it's more variable. It could be iso, hypo, or hyper. The post gadolinium enhanced scans may show intense homogeneous enhancement. However, in some areas may be enhancing and non-enhancing, giving a heterogeneous picture. Complete central non-enhancement of the lesion may be seen if there is severe necrosis in the area. MRI is useful in detecting the orbital cellulitis, cavernous sinus thrombosis, internal carotid artery thrombosis, cerebritis, infarcts, and abscesses, which we know are bad prognostic factors for the disease. So here, in this picture, we can see a hypointense lesion involving the ethmoid sinus and the turbinates. In the T2 weighted one, it is enhancing, it is hyperintense. And in the contrast enhanced scan, we can see that some areas are enhancing while the others are non-enhancing. At this point, I would like to say that during this ongoing pandemic, we have made a small change in our protocol where we don't insist on a diagnostic nasal endoscopy for all patients. The diagnosis can be based on the history, the clinical findings, and the radiological findings. And the samples for the fungal culture and the biopsy can be obtained during surgery. So to conclude, we need to have a high index of suspicion to diagnose mucormycosis in its early stages. For any high-risk patient, any facial symptom, orbital symptom, or palatal symptom, however insignificant they look like, should not be disregarded. Fungal smear, frozen section, and an urgent histopathological examination will help in early diagnosis. Imaging helps us to assess the extent of the disease and to plan the surgical approach. However, early surgical debridement followed by antifungal therapy gives the patient a favorable outcome. In this slide, I've just tried to put in a nutshell whatever we have discussed over the past few minutes about the disease. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lali, for that very comprehensive talk on clinical features and evaluation of patients with suspected mucormycosis. That was very nice. Now we go on to the next speaker, who is Dr. Reggie Kurian. Dr. Reggie Kurian is professor and acting head of the rhinology unit of ENT. He has shown great leadership skills in handling the present crisis. We've been having a whole lot of problems with the management, the evaluation and management of these patients, and each of these problems was sorted out along the way. Dr. Reggie will be talking about the surgical management of mucormycosis. This is a very sort of challenging situation. Over to you, Reggie.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, ma'am, for the introduction. At the onset, I would like to thank the administration and the COVID Command Center for giving us this opportunity to speak on this topic, especially during this COVID surge and especially with the surge of patients with mucormycosis. After Lali's talk on the clinical evaluation and presentation of patients with mucormycosis, I would like to shift your attention to the surgical management and the surgical aspects of this disease. So as we all know, acute invasive fungal sinusitis is a highly aggressive angioinvasive fungal disease which spreads quite rapidly and is seen mainly in patients with some sort of an immunocompromised status. And because of the rapidity with which this disease progresses and because of the high mortality rates, if the patient is untreated, this condition needs to be treated as a medical and surgical emergency. So the main treatment modalities, they have basically divided into two parts. One is a surgical debridement followed by early initiation of antifungal therapy. And I'm going to have this lecture basically on the surgical debridement of this condition. So the first question which we need to ask is, why surgery and what is the importance of surgery? So in mucormycosis, there is extensive thrombosis and tissue necrosis, and we need to completely remove and debride all this necrotic tissue within the sinonasal region, extending even extraparanasally. And this reduces the fungal burden and improves the penetration of antifungals into the tissue. Secondly, even in patients with hematological malignancies, it helps in recovering the neutrophils and also in the recovery of the immunological status of the patients. Also, if you go back through to literature, we see that surgery is an independent prognostic factor for a successful and favorable outcome in patients with mucormycosis. And patients who have not had surgery tend to have a much worse prognosis compared to those who have had surgery. Now, the next question is regarding the surgical resectability. Can surgery completely remove the entire disease? And to answer this question, we had devised a staging protocol wherein the patients were staged based on the clinical radiological evidence of disease. And as Lali had mentioned in the previous lecture, we have three stages of disease. And it is in stage three where you have unresectable disease, especially when it's present in the cavernous sinus, the orbital apex, the anterior skull base, and even in the intraparenchymal part of the brain. So it is these patients, stage three patients, who have unresectable disease. And obviously, they have a much poorer prognosis with a higher mortality rate. So as we know that many of these surgeries need to be done on an emergency basis, we need to have a proper consultation with the anesthetic team. The patients are often quite sick, and a proper assessment of their fitness for a general anesthesia and correction of various medical abnormalities also have to be done. If required, an ICU backup needs to be organized. And many of these patients have multidisciplinary involvement, or patients with orbital involvement, with intracranial involvement, and all proper multidisciplinary consultations needs to be done before. These need to be documented, and a treatment plan needs to be made, explained to the patient, and appropriate consent needs to be taken before embarking on surgery. Now, in the pre-endoscopic era, there used to be a lot of external approaches to access the sinuses, like a lateral rhinotomy incision and external ethmoidectomy incision. But nowadays, with the advent of the endoscope, we have much better visualization, much better precise surgery, and all these can be done with much better clarity with the same outcomes. What are the prerequisites for surgery? One needs to have a CT scan, which acts as a roadmap for the surgeon. It defines the bony architecture, the anatomy of the sinuses, and also if there are any anatomical anomalies, the surgeon can be prepared beforehand itself. If there are any intracranial or orbital involvement, an MRI scan of the brain and orbit is also required. Now, a standard surgical procedure would be a complete endoscopic sinonasal debridement, wherein we open all the sinuses completely, radically and aggressively remove all the diseased mucosa from the inside of the sinuses. This is actually in contrary to what we practice in chronic sinusitis or FES surgery, where the mucosa is actually preserved. But in mucormycosis, we need to aggressively remove all the diseased mucosa. So with regards to the maxillary sinus, we do a wide meatal antrostomy. If the inferior turbinate is involved, an endoscopic medial maxillectomy needs to be performed. Anterior and posterior ethmoidectomy, the sphenoid sinus is open, the frontal recess, and the frontal sinus is completely cleared of the disease. Now, earlier, we used to see a few patients used to come back with disease in the unopened sinuses, and this has actually changed our surgical protocol, wherein we open up all the sinuses widely, irrespective of the disease present on imaging. And in this article, which was published, we saw that there was a presence of histologically positive fungal disease in radiologically uninvolved sinuses in 12% of the patient. Now, depending upon the extent of disease, additional surgical resection will need to be performed. So if the inferior turbinate is involved or the middle turbinate, these need to be excised. Involvement of the septum will require a partial or a total septectomy. If the premaxillary area is involved, that is the area in front of the cheek or the inside the cheek or the anterior wall of the maxilla, this area needs to be debrided through a sublabial approach and sometimes in combination with a cadaveric clearance of the maxillary sinus. Now, many patients also have involvement of the palate, and palatal surgeries will again need to be tailored depending upon the extent of the lesion. So if you have just minimal involvement of the palatal mucosa, one can do just a wide palatal mucosal excision like what is shown in this picture. And this area nicely granulates in the postoperative period. If you have underlying palatal bone healthy, then one needs to do a palatectomy. Or if the alveolus is also healthy, then one needs to go and do an inferior partial maxillectomy. Now, sometimes you have a normal palatal mucosa, but underlying osteomyelitic or necrotic palatal bone. And in that case, the bone alone needs to be removed, and the normal looking palatal mucosa then can be sutured to the buccal mucosa, giving a good oronasal separation, which improves the postoperative feeding in these patients. Now, the pterygopalatine fossa, another area which is actually situated behind the posterior wall of the maxilla, serves as a reservoir of fungal infection. And if this area is not addressed, then this can the disease can spread to surrounding orbital and intracranial spaces. So it's very important that we assess this area preoperatively with a CT scan or MRI scan. And if there is any evidence of loss of fat planes or fat stranding, then intraoperatively, this area needs to be opened up. Now, with the availability of endoscopes, this area can be accessed very easily, and complete debridement of this area is important to improve the survival rates. So this endoscopic picture shows the posterior wall of the maxilla, completely necrotic, and we see the disease extending to the sphenopalatine region in the second picture. So in this picture, we see that the entire posterior wall of the maxilla is completely removed. You have necrotic tissue lying in the pterygopalatine fossa, extending to the infratemporal fossa. The contents of the pterygopalatine fossa is isolated, the internal maxillary artery is isolated. If possible, clips are placed, and then the artery is divided, and the entire tissue is debrided until we reach bare bone and vascularized tissue. Now, patients also might require different types of maxillectomy if the maxillary bone as such is involved. And again, we require external approaches like a sublabial approach, or if there is bilateral involvement, we might need a midfacial degloving approach also. So depending upon the extent of involvement of the maxillary sinus, one can do a medial maxillectomy or an inferior partial maxillectomy. Sometimes all the three walls are involved, then one might do a subtotal maxillectomy. And if the entire maxillary bone on one side is involved, we can go ahead and do a total maxillectomy. So basically, the type of maxillectomy needs to be tailored depending upon the extent of diseased bone and the extent of involvement of the bone. So postoperatively, we pack the maxillectomy cavity with the BIPS pack, and this is left in situ for 48 hours, after which it is removed. Now, all the patients in the postoperative period receive nasal douching after the packs are removed, and this helps in actually clearing the nasal secretions and the crusting inside the nose. Patients used to be called weekly to the OPD for a weekly endoscopic debridement. However, during this COVID pandemic, we have stopped doing that, and we call patients only after the quarantine period is over. Now, in the OPD, the postoperative bed is endoscopically the surveillance is done. And at the end of the antifungal therapy, a biopsy of the postoperative cavity is taken. And if negative, the patient is followed up every 3 months, and thereafter twice a year on follow-up. Every surgery has its own complications, and it's important that the surgeon avoids these complications as if possible. Especially the most dangerous ones are iatrogenic CSF leaks. And this needs to be assessed again on preoperative scans. If the if you see any erosion of the skull base or even on table, if there is a blackish or an unhealthy skull base, one needs to do not try to attempt to remove this necrotic tissue, because this can lead to fatal CSF leak. And even if you repair this, it can lead to fungal meningitis, and the outcomes are quite poor. Again, patients who have a healthy orbit and normal vision, one needs to be cautious while working in the ethmoid region and try to avoid damage to the orbit and the optic nerve. And this again requires a pre-operative assessment of the CT scan. At the end of the surgery, one needs to make sure that there is no bleeding. All the vessels are cauterized and if necessary ligated, and make sure that there's proper hemostasis at the end of surgery. Many of the patients who have undergone a total maxillectomy will require a prosthesis of some kind. So initially we give a temporary prosthesis, and then this is, once the healing is over, we give a final prosthesis mostly at the end of 3 months. So to conclude, the treatment of mucormycosis is a comprehensive and requires a multidisciplinary approach. Every surgery needs to be tailored according to the extent of the disease, and very early and aggressive surgical debridement needs to be done so that you have favorable outcomes in the postoperative period. To end, I would like to extend a big thank you to the administration and all the departments who were actually involved in the treatment of all these patients. As mentioned earlier, this is a multidisciplinary approach, and there are a lot of departments who have come forward, and all the support required is a big thank you for all the people who are involved in the treatment of these patients. And also, these surgeries wouldn't have been possible with a proper and efficient anesthetic team. And a big thank you to each and every member of this team, the doctors in the ICU, the COVID wards, and all the other personnel involved in the treatment of this condition. Once again, a big thank you for your patient listening. Thank you.
Thank you, Reggie, for that very systematic account on the surgical management of mucormycosis. You emphasized the importance of early surgery and also highlighted the importance of a good anesthetic team, which we are really fortunate to have. I will now call upon the next speaker, who is Dr. Jayanti. Dr. Jayanti Peter is the Associate Professor of Ophthalmology in the Ophthalmology Department of CMC. She has been a very enthusiastic, capable, and a very easily approachable person. And this is just the kind of ophthalmologist you need for the kind of cases that we see here. Dr. Jayanti has helped us every step of the way in making decisions on how the eye has to be addressed in these patients. And here I call upon Jayanti to go ahead and make her presentation.
I've been asked to talk on the clinical manifestations and management of orbital mucormycosis. In my talk, I would be covering only the eye point of view as to what we as ophthalmologists are encountering in this COVID era. The outline of my talk will be on the red flags which make us suspect a mucor in a patient, the symptoms and signs, the investigations, treatment, and how we can prevent the major catastrophe to be happening. As we all know, rhino-orbital mucormycosis is an infection primarily of the paranasal sinuses, which can eventually spread to the orbit and the brain. And it can cause significant disfigurement, and it can potentially be lethal to patients when they come at a very late stage or when they end up being untreated. Earlier, we know that diabetics and immunosuppressed and patients who have malignancy and on chemotherapy are very prone to mucormycosis. But during this COVID era, we realized that the mucormycosis which is presenting now is much more aggressive compared to which has happened in the past. So what are the red flags in this COVID era? We need to know that patients who have uncontrolled diabetes, who are on immunosuppressive drugs, and on steroids post-COVID and tocilizumab therapy, and patients who have never had diabetes in the past, maybe they have would have been in the pre-diabetic state, or they have never ventured out to check a blood sugar. They've all are known to have risk factor for mucormycosis. The postulated theory would be that probably COVID itself can cause immunosuppression, which can lead to mucormycosis. Those on oxygen therapy during COVID, sharing of masks, and eventually all these patients have had some kind of teeth-related problem, and they all present themselves after it, teeth extraction. The symptoms are, usually they present even to the eye department with the presence of cheek swelling, facial pain, loss of sensation, and headache. From a nasal point of view, they do complain of stuffiness, discharge, and bleeding. And a very late stage, they present to casualty with altered sensorium and weakness of limbs. As far as eye-related symptoms are concerned, they present with eye pain or retroorbital pain. They complain of decreased vision of or total loss of vision. They complain of drooping of eyelids, protrusion of eyeballs, maybe even bilaterally sometimes, and double vision, and a difficulty in closing their eyelids. On examination, we find that on the skin of all these patients, they have what is looking like an eschar due to the angioinvasion of these mucormycosis invading the blood supply to the eyelids and the surrounding area. They have these dark discoloration of the skin, which eventually leads to an ulcer. Unfortunately, when you see patients with such dark eschar, we realize that they are not doing quite well as far as the mucormycosis is concerned. They can present with lagophthalmos, which may represent a skull-based osteolitis, which presents with difficulty in closing their eyes. And decreased vision may be just a mild blurring of vision to a loss of perception of light. They present with proptosis, and which can easily be figured out with by looking at the comparing with the other eye. They can present with lid edema, mild ptosis, or a total complete ptosis where they the eye is completely closed. They can present with restriction of extraocular movements. Coming to the signs, they can present with chemosis, which is congestion and ballooning of the conjunctiva. They can have a relative afferent pupillary defect, which means that the optic nerve is involved. And they can present with either a normal fundus, or they can have diabetic retinopathy in the fundus. When there is compression of the optic nerve, they can present with disc edema, or they can have optic neuritis-like picture. They can also have a central retinal artery occlusion, suggesting that the blood supply to the retina is completely closed off. A very late stage, they can present with an endogenous endophthalmitis or an anterior segment ischemia, where the cornea is completely hazy. We come to a diagnosis as suggested by many of my colleagues with a high index of suspicion, especially during this COVID era. We do normally a nasal endoscopy, but because of the current guidelines, we go ahead on suspicion straight for any surgery which is needed. Histopathology will definitely show angioinvasion, and rest of the parameters like blood sugars and hemoglobin A1C would reveal that all along these people have been diabetics, which has never been picked up before. As long as imaging is done, we are first recommending a CT scan to be done, which includes paranasal sinuses and the orbit. And we do not order an MRI straight away unless we suspect an intracranial extension or worsening during the course of the management. As far as the orbital involvement, there can be mild fat stranding or thickening of the muscles. And they can also present with intraorbital or subperiosteal abscesses, presence of necrotic tissue inside the orbit. There may be an orbital apex syndrome where the optic canal and the apex is involved, a superior orbital fissure syndrome where all the structures around the superior orbital fissure is affected, and superior ophthalmic vein thrombosis can occur. And sometimes they can present with a compartment syndrome when the whole orbit is filled either with due to the inflammation or the necrotic tissue itself. As you can see in this picture, where you can have what is called as a guitar pick sign, where the globe is completely tented, and the patient is in a lot of pain. As far as the intracranial involvement is concerned, through the optic canal, they can go and have cavernous sinus involvement, intracranial abscesses, infarcts in the brain. And as an ophthalmologist, we should be particularly looking for any thinning of the cribriform plate with any involvement of the dura, presence of any cerebritis, or because we need to be aware that during surgery, we do not want a CSF leak to occur. As far as the treatment is concerned, we try to preserve vision as far as possible by doing conservative management like canthotomy and cantholysis, especially in the, as I showed in the previous picture, when the orbit is very tight and there is an orbital compartment syndrome. We do a canthotomy and release the pressure of the orbit so that the optic nerve is loosened up a little bit so that it can survive the pressures of the within the orbit. We can debride the orbit of the necrotic tissue, which is extending from the sinuses. And if there's any abscess, we plan to drain it as well. If there is a vision loss with extensive orbital involvement, we do go ahead with the excentration, but we keep this as a last resort. Patients, however, with apical involvement, with only the orbital apex involved, with no other signs of involvement and inflammation of the orbit per se, we manage conservatively only with antifungals. As far as the orbital surgeries are concerned, we help out the ENT surgeons by helping them debride the tissues around the orbit by tagging the extraocular muscles. We drain the subperiosteal abscesses, which are associated with the mucor, and we do orbital debridement and removal of the necrotic tissue as well as excentration. I would like to illustrate the orbital management with just showing a few cases. This is a man who's a 28-year-old who was a diabetic, came with a facial swelling and edema. As you can see, there is a mild edema and a mild ptosis of the left eye, but this man did not have any eyelid, any other problems as far as the vision is concerned or extraocular movements. This patient was conservatively managed, and today is the 15th post-op day where a FES was done. And he's continuing to have a good vision. In fact, the lid edema and the ptosis has improved dramatically. When the patient presents with a superior orbital abscess or any orbital abscess, as you can see in the picture in this MRI, we went ahead and drained the orbital abscess. And this again, this is a 15th post-op day where the patient has recovered quite well. The reason we resort to these conservative management is so that the patient can retain is good vision. Again, this person had a 54-year-old diabetic recovered from COVID. He actually presented with only a dental pain with a mild facial swelling. He did not have any other problems except for very mild blurred vision, which when we rechecked was actually quite normal. This patient had, on CT scan, we found that he had a very small abscess in the inferior part. And this abscess was drained along with the FES when the maxillectomy was done. Inferior orbital debridement was done for this person who has had periorbital swelling and pain. So when we found out that he had only the necrotic tissue involving the inferior orbital area, we actually tagged the inferior rectus muscle and kept it much away from the maxillary sinus so that the ENT surgeons, when they were doing the maxillectomy, the abscess was drained through the through the endoscopic route. As described earlier, we do canthotomy and cantholysis for patients who have had with a tight orbit with orbital compartment syndrome. We do not do excentration unless we have a frozen biopsy of these patients, which is shown to have mucormycosis and there is total loss of vision, in which case we go ahead and excentrate the patient where we remove the contents of the orbit fully. This is a post-op picture of a person where the orbit is completely clean, devoid of any necrotic tissue. And this is how the picture looks when the eyelid is closed. There are other treatment modalities which has been described before. In the pre-COVID era, we did try some intraorbital amphotericin for a few patients who did not want excentration to be done. But unfortunately, the patients who had intraorbital amphotericin ended up having a severe reaction. So we had to stop using intraorbital amphotericin. There are a few reports which has described retrobulbar alcohol injection, But again, retrobulbar, any injection in the retrobulbar area is not routinely done as far as ophthalmology is concerned due to the risk of intraorbital retrobulbar hemorrhages. So we don't practice this in CMC. It's not always doom and gloom. Patients who have completely recovered after 6 months of total fungal-free period, we do give them a prosthesis which is both spectacle-mounted and an orbital prosthesis, which can be attached to the socket area. So the algorithm for the treatment as far as orbit is concerned is, when we suspect a mucor, when there aren't any signs or symptoms as far as eye is concerned, we keep monitoring them when the sinuses are full of when they have sinusitis. But when the signs and symptoms are recorded once, we keep following them up with their CT scan or nasal endoscopy or a frozen section. When the orbit is not involved, we again keep them on observation and keep following them on antifungals. But when the orbit is involved, when there is a good vision, we still go ahead for a conservative management where we do a debridement along with FS. But when the vision is poor, when the total orbital involvement is there, we go ahead after frozen section with orbital excentration. Prognosis-wise, patients who present early, younger patients with very minimal sinus and eye involvement, and those not in DK, diabetic ketoacidosis tend to do well. However, patients who present late and older patients with severe COVID and those with extensive disease involving all the sinuses with intracranial involvement tend to do poorly. So we do understand that during this COVID era, the disease is much more aggressive than before. Lockdown has not helped uncontrolled diabetics at all. Due to lack of medicines and lack of finances, they don't go for a routine follow-up to get their medicines. A late presentation due to the fear of getting COVID and steroid exposure has pushed them into clinical diabetes, and sharing of masks and moist masks have not made it better for them as far as mucor is concerned. The take-home message is we need to have a very high index of suspicion. We need to detect them early, and early intervention is the key. Very strict diabetic control and vaccinate against COVID. I would like to thank all the multidisciplinary team who has been involved as far as treating mucor, and I like to acknowledge our ophthal team who has helped us by working tirelessly during the last month or so. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jayanti, for that very nice talk, as well as illustration of various cases. There seem to be a few questions for you, and I hope you will look at the chat box and answer those questions. We now take a sort of right angle turn and look at a very important component of the management of mucormycosis, which is the medical management of mucormycosis. And for that topic, I invite Dr. George Verghese, professor and head of the Department of Infectious Diseases at CMC Vellore. Dr. George Verghese has worked very closely with us in sort of fine-tuning the medical management of these very difficult cases. There always seems to be one question, and I can see that he has got a lot of questions to answer in the chat box today, but I hope most of these questions are answered in his talk. He has helped us, especially in the management of patients who cannot tolerate amphotericin B or looked at alternatives to amphotericin B, step down treatment, salvage therapies, a lot of very interesting things that he will talk to you about. And I will now hand over to him. George, please go ahead.
Thank you, Dr. Rupa, for your kind words. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As we were enduring the second wave of COVID-19 pandemic, by end of April, we started seeing large number of cases of mucormycosis. As you can see, in the past 1 year, less than 1 year, we have seen more than 150 cases, out of which in the last 1 month, we have seen close to 90 cases of invasive mucormycosis. Although mucormycosis has been already there. The COVID has really pushed the mucormycosis to cause a significant epidemic, and we will look at why could that be. And when the surge occurred, we realized that almost all of them were diagnosed to have COVID recently. Before the pandemic, we know that in our setting, what we see is the rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. Unlike the Western cohort of patients, where they see invasive mucor mostly in the lung, occasionally in the sinuses, those patients are, majority of them are neutropenic or severely immunocompromised. Their outcome is extremely poor. This review of about 10-year data from our institution, which was published 5 years ago, you can see that the in-hospital mortality in these patients with predominantly constituting rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis was about 30%. It also has a significant morbidity. It's a disfiguring disease. It's a devastating disease with poor quality of life, even when they survive. And this is primarily because our only choice of treatment was conventional amphotericin, which is toxic. So at the end of the whole thing, it was a terrible disease to manage, and it was very bad disease for the patients to endure as well. So the early diagnosis had become quite crucial, and now it is even more important. You can see that if you look at the treatment of treatment of mucormycosis, what is recommended or the guidelines, you can see that there are three important components one needs to address: the source reduction with surgery, antifungal therapy, and immune restoration by optimal control of sugars, stopping or reducing immunosuppression. Now, what they recommend is 4 to 6 weeks of initial IV therapy, and most effective drug is liposomal amphotericin for that. And you know that vast majority of our patients will not be able to afford that. Liposomal amphotericin costs roughly about 45,000 rupees per day. And you can imagine for 4 to 6 weeks of therapy, very few patients will be able to afford in our kind of setting. The second option of lipid complex amphotericin B, probably half the cost, is much better than the conventional amphotericin or the deoxycholate amphotericin B. The deoxycholate amphotericin B, although it used to be the drug which was available, and that was the only option available, it used to give some reasonable efficacy, but at the end of it, a lot of side effects and issues to tackle even after that. Then came the era of newer azoles. The posaconazole, about 10 years ago, we started, posaconazole was approved, and subsequently about 5 years ago, isavuconazole. Now, step-down therapy, these two drugs have made much easier. Oral posaconazole or isavuconazole, which needs to be taken for about 3 to 6 months. So when you look at any of these guidelines, they are talking about severely immunocompromised patients, which they see in the West. I'll come back to those kind of patients. Now, about 7-8 years ago, we decided to look at our set of patients who could not tolerate conventional amphotericin. Majority of them were uncontrolled diabetics who had worsening renal function on amphotericin B or residual disease. We started using posaconazole. Oral posaconazole available at that time was syrup posaconazole with much less oral bioavailability. And therefore, even with that, we tried to develop some evidence, and we found that in our set of patients, the treatment success was very good. And we found that the serum levels we were able to document in a significant proportion of them and getting a good outcome in those patients. This was the study which I was referring to was published in 2016. The same year, the isavuconazole came up with the initial studies, including 37 patients. You can see that 60% of them were patients with hematological malignancy, 27% neutropenics. And the treatment of isavuconazole, this was a single-arm trial. Their control arm was matched case control analysis from a database. And they looked at the all-cause mortality at 42 days and the overall response. You can see that there's no difference between isavuconazole and the amphotericin group. The amphotericin which they used was either liposomal amphotericin or lipid complex amphotericin in 80% of patients. And the overall mortality was about 35%. And this is what they talk about, the kind of patients and the treatment recommendations based on these kind of cohorts. So the in 2019, the European group came up with the treatment guidelines. I don't expect you to read this, but I wanted you to take three or four messages from the slide. They discourage the use of conventional amphotericin primarily because of the toxicity. Number two, the first drug of choice is liposomal amphotericin at 5 mg/kg dose, unless there is CNS disease. So CNS disease, they have even, they are recommending based on evidence, 10 mg/kg. Number three is when there is renal failure, one can go on to use either posaconazole or isavuconazole upfront. And this is the recommendation by and large they follow elsewhere in the world. This will be followed up by oral therapy with isavuconazole or posaconazole. So we decided to revisit the treatment approach for rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis in the beginning of 2020. So we our concept was shortened initial IV therapy followed by an oral therapy. We called it a POIS MUCA study, which was IRB approved, and we started this as a prospective cohort in June 2020. So when the epidemic started, we were actually, we had already started this prospective cohort study. We were looking at adult patients with diabetes-associated rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. Our treatment strategy was based on the extent of the involvement, short IV therapy in the absence of CNS disease or internal carotid artery involvement. The primary outcome we intend to look at is the treatment success measured as a composite of survival at 14 weeks with lack of progressive disease assessed by rhinoscopy and imaging. And we also look at the secondary endpoints such as overall survival rate at 24 weeks after a study entry, persistent disease requiring continued antifungal therapy beyond 3 months, and Lyme-related bacteremia and other complications. This, we do it based on the disease severity, both clinical and radiological disease severity put together. We carefully look at the involvement, whether there's any CNS parenchymal involvement in the form of cerebritis or infarct. Are they abscesses? Is there cavernous sinus or the internal carotid involvement? Orbital involvement, is it orbital apex syndrome versus the extent of soft tissue involvement, including osteomyelitis and sinus, extra sinus soft tissue involvement, we look at it carefully. And then what do? We look at, give treatment for the ones with CNS involvement. By the way, this group of patients with CNS involvement or internal carotid thrombosis involvement is roughly about 10 or 15%. You can actually make a huge difference in the remaining 80, 85% of patients who do not have this. So this group, their prognosis is poor. We continue to use long IV therapy. The shorter treatment group, again, we divide them into two, either sinus limited disease or minimal orbital or extra sinus disease with 1 week of IV therapy followed by oral therapy. When there is extensive orbital disease or orbital apex involvement or cavernous sinus involvement or extensive osteomyelitis, we treat them for 2 weeks, treat them with 2 weeks of IV therapy. What do we continue? We continue posaconazole. On day one, you have to give a loading, 300 milligrams twice daily, followed by 300 milligrams once daily. If there is a CNS disease, we hike up the dose of oral posaconazole to 400 milligrams once daily. Just to give you some practical tips of how do we give the IV therapy, the liposomal amphotericin, 5 milligrams per kilo, most commonly, unless there is CNS involvement, in 500 ml of 5% dextrose over 3 to 4 hours. It's the same with lipid complex amphotericin, which is usually given at 3 to 5 milligrams per kilo, carefully monitoring the renal parameters, et cetera. The conventional amphotericin we use 1 milligram per kilo. Maximum, we might be able to go up to 1.5 per kilo. This has to be infused through a central line because it is thrombogenic. There is quite a lot of thrombophlebitis, which you will see if you don't give it through a central line. Pre and post hydration with normal saline before and after AMFO will reduce the nephrotoxicity. And you also give pre-medication with Avil and paracetamol. This usually is tablet Avil, 25 milligrams. There's an error there, along with paracetamol, what we give. This is to avoid the infusion-related toxicity, fever, chills, and rigors, which are seen most commonly with conventional amphotericin. Potassium and magnesium has to be monitored carefully, particularly with conventional amphotericin. Almost all of them develop hypokalemia, so you have to supplement IV potassium along with the dextrose or the normal saline, which you give after the amphotericin. You monitor the hemoglobin, creatinine, and potassium. Hemoglobin probably twice a week, once or twice a week, and creatinine and potassium on alternate days. When we looked at about 42 patients as an interim analysis for our approach who had completed 3 months of follow-up, what we found is overall successful outcome is 78%. Alive at 14 weeks and no progression of disease. And outcome without CNS involvement is even better. Outcome among those with CNS disease is about 57%. Our overall mortality rate was 7%, which is much less than what we used to see earlier and also the Western literature. The three people who died, we looked at one had a refractory hypokalemia and had a sudden cardiac death at home. The second one had critical COVID and expired due to COVID. And the third one due to mechanical valve failure of an old double valve replacement and cardiac death at home in the third patient. The drug-related side effects, what we see is Most commonly, the acute kidney injury in about a third of patients, hypokalemia in almost all of them when you're using conventional amphotericin, and therefore you need to supplement the potassium. Renal tubular toxicity and infusion-related toxicity are the most dreaded complications of conventional amphotericin. The catheter-associated bloodstream infections in about 20% of patients, which is again, which adds to the complications and the cost, etc. Oral posaconazole, again, you must remember that there is it inhibits the CYP enzyme, CYP11B, and therefore there is a pseudo hyperaldosteronism kind of features with hypokalemia and hypertension in a proportion of patients. The risk factors for developing COVID during the pandemic, we just had a quick analysis of our initial patients, about 120 odd patients. We can see that not only the diabetes of course was obvious, steroid use pushing the epidemic, and also there is more and more evidence to say that COVID itself is doing something to the immune system. As you know, in mucor, iron metabolism is important. When you look at the ferritin, there is a difference. While CRP, there is no difference, which tells you that it's just not the inflammation alone. There is more than what is seen with COVID. To conclude, early diagnosis improves the outcome. Source reduction with surgery is crucial, and that also gives you the diagnostic confirmation. Antifungal therapy based on the extent of involvement, initial IV therapy followed by step-down oral therapy with posaconazole is what is most commonly used. Monitor drug-related side effects and immune restoration by optimal sugar control and reducing the immunosuppression. Thank you very much for your patient listening. And I also acknowledge all the members of the multidisciplinary team, and also our team, particularly Abhimanesh and Banu, who put in a lot of effort in doing so. Thank you very much.
Thank you, George, for that very comprehensive account of antifungal therapy. Also sharing details of the posaconazole study, which gives hope actually, especially in a situation where amphotericin B has been found to be very difficult to sort of get in many centers across the country. I also like the risk factor comparison, and I think we should actually compare this with the most recent publication on this from the MucoCOVID group, which has just come out in the Clinical Infectious Disease Journal. So that actually would be nice, because I can see that some of the findings in that you have mentioned in your slide are a little different from what they have found. So we now move on to nursing care. Now, it's very easy for us to sort of say we are treating these patients medically, surgically, but we need to give sufficient importance to nursing care and the management of these patients. And here I will call upon Mrs. Naomi Naveen, who is nurse manager, specialty one nursing at CMC. She will talk about nursing management in mucormycosis.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am. At the outset, I would like to thank the CCC Training Desk, Office of the Nursing Superintendent, and the ENT department for giving me this opportunity. And nurses play a vital role in any clinical management of patients. And nurses are the closest to the patients. Hence, nurses need to have the right knowledge and competencies for better patient outcomes. I would be concentrating on the role of nurses in this presentation, mainly in terms of preoperative assessment, postoperative nursing care, antifungal therapy, nutrition and psychological support, communication, and health education. Like we had seen in the previous presentations, most often these patients present to us with severe pain, commonly a facial pain, headache. And when you assess their pain scores are usually above 7 on 10. So ice application is an important thing that will and help our patients relieve from the pain. So ice application over the cheeks and periorbital region are done. And oral hygiene is also taught during this time. And since this disease is a very progressive disease, most often these patients are taken for emergency surgery. So preparing these patients for emergency surgery is very important. And fever management, they present with low-grade fever and high-grade fever. So administration of antipyretics and cold sponging and cold application is very important. And post-operative nursing care, like Dr. Reggie discussed, most often these patients undergo endoscopic debridement along with maxillectomy, also orbital excentration based on the clinical presentation. The standard care is that on the second or the third post-operative day, these patients will have their nasal pack removed. So they need to be taught on the nasal douching or the use of nasal spray every 2 hourly. If you see, nasal douching is an important thing that they need to do to help clean the nasal mucosa and sinuses. After the surgery, the surface of the nose becomes raw and sore, and the mucus that is produced by the nose keeps the raw area soggy. Sometimes the mucus can become very dry, and that makes a crust to be formed. So this drying can actually impede the healing process, and infections can develop. So patients need to be taught on appropriate nasal douching. If you can see this picture, we use a nasal wash kit, which is a pressure-filled container. So we fill normal saline, and you can see a patient doing a nasal douching here. So the patient has to be taught on her, if you taught on how to do the nasal douching procedure. So the patient is taught to do the nasal douching on one nostril, and the fluid should come out on the other nostril. If you do not have a nasal douche kit, you can also use a 50 cc syringe, and NG tube can be cut and fixed onto the tip, and you can use normal saline or saline water to flush the nasal cavity. Usually our patients are sent weekly to the OPD, ENT OPD for endoscopic cleaning. And now when the patient becomes COVID negative, we send them for endoscopic cleaning. Some of the problems that we face with COVID positive patients are that these patients are in isolation, and regular saline douching cannot be taught and monitored for these patients after pack removal. And because these patients are COVID positive, endoscopic cleaning cannot be done until 2 weeks. So they need to be taught on saline sprays, 3 to 4 sprays per nostril every hour during waking hours is recommended for them. And intubated patients pose a special challenge for this procedure. And we had just heard about the antifungal management, and sir had discussed on the various antifungal therapy that we are using here. And the most commonly used drug here is amphotericin. And nurses need to be aware of this drug, though this drug is a savior, but it is a very toxic drug. So it needs to be administered slowly over 2 to 6 hours. Longer the duration, the better the tolerance. And it is preferable to administer this drug through an infusion pump, and always ensure that you are giving pre and post hydration before administering the injection amphotericin, because this decreases the nephrotoxicity. And pre and post hydration is done with 0.9% normal saline, 500 ml over 4 hours. Like sir had discussed, most of these patients go into hypokalemia. Usually we have potassium correction, and always administer pre-medication before you administer amphotericin. And also check the IV line before infusion. Watch for signs and symptoms of erythema. And it is preferable to administer through a central venous line. though you give the pre-hydration and post-hydration with normal saline, the drug has to be diluted with 5% dextrose of 10% dextrose. And the reconstitution and administration with strict aseptic techniques are very important. Most of these patients present with centraline associated infections. So strict aseptic techniques are very important. And change the IV centraline dressing every 72 hours and check if the patient complains of pain at IV site or if there's any redness. And like we said, this drug is nephrotoxic. So monitoring for the renal functions are very important. So a strict intake output chart has to be maintained because renal damage is reversible if the drug is discontinued when the first signs of renal dysfunction appear. So watch for oliguria, change in intake output ratio and pattern, and appearance of urine. These are the red flags of renal damage. And also watch for fluid and electrolyte imbalance and monitor their vital signs, including BP, to ensure fluid balance. And some of the problems that the patients who undergo maxillectomy experience are their speech will get affected because their maxilla is removed, and also their feeding will be affected. So there's also there's a need for cleaning the nasal cavities and oral cavities is there. So the importance of doing a nasal douching, the feeding techniques are very important. So they need to be taught on that. They need to be taught on the oral hygiene. Use of thymol glycerin or chlorhexidine mouthwash every 4 hourly has to be taught for these patients. And if the patients are COVID negative, send them to ENT OPD for weekly cavity debridement. Nutrition plays an important role. In the initial period, these patients will have a nasogastric tube. Later, when they get discharged, because their maxilla will be removed and they will have a lot of soreness, you can encourage the patients to take a pharyngeal feeding because it's closest to the oral feeding and there's a lesser risk of aspiration. You can use a pharyngeal feeding cups. We are now using a modified our nasal douche bottles, and we fix the NG tube. Because it is a pressure-filled container, it helps the patient to take the fluids easily into the pharynx. So also you can encourage alternative feeding methods for these patients with long spoons and straws. You can encourage liquid diet in earlier stages, and later slowly they can move with semi-solids and to finally to solids. Like Dr. Reggie had discussed, patients after maxillectomy will have a temporary palatal prosthesis. So patients should be taught on how to care for this, because when the patients undergo a maxillectomy, you basically have a oronasal fistula. So when the patients feed, they might aspirate and the food might come into the nose. So to prevent this, patients will have a palatal prosthesis. So patients should be taught to clean this prosthesis after every meal with soap and water, and they can use brush if the food gets stuck in that. And the patient should be taught on the insertion of this palatal prosthesis without any injury, and report if there is any pain when inserting this prosthesis. And orbital excentration is another surgery that is being done for these patients. So patients should be advised to keep the eye socket covered with gauze pack after the removal of the eye, because this might harbor flies and maggots. So you have to ensure that you educate the patients to prevent meiosis by covering the eye socket. Eventually, the eye socket will be lined with skin and healthy mucosa. And also reassuring the patients is very important. Most often these patients come with ptosis and they end up because this fungus is rapidly progressive, it quickly spreads and they tend to lose their vision. So you need to give them a lot of reassurance and communicate to them what is happening to them, and provide them psychological support. So provide them with call bells and also ensure the safety measures, because they don't have their vision. So prevention of injury has to be taken care. And because the patients have their maxilla removed, most often their speech will not be very clear. So the family members have to be educated and involved in communicating to the healthcare members and also to the family. And communication will be unclear without prosthesis. And obturator is nothing but the processes. So they need to be taught on the care, and regular dental checkups also need to be followed up. And information on artificial eyeballs and cosmesis also need to be given to the patients. In conclusion, I want to say that COVID pandemic has resulted in increased number of cases of mucormycosis, and large number of emergency operations are being done at CMC over the last 2 months for these patients. And pre-operative and post-operative nursing measures are required, and our patients present with altered speech and feeding difficulties. So appropriate nursing techniques have to be taught to these patients for a better quality of life. And diabetes is another major risk factor for the disease, and nurses have to educate the patients on strict control of diabetes, which will reduce the mortality and morbidity. And nurses familiar with ENT nursing techniques are very essential in managing this patients. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Sister Naomi, for that very comprehensive talk and for covering all the practical points that are involved in the management of these patients. So now we come to the end of this really interesting and exciting session. We've had speakers cover almost all the areas. To sort of give an overview, I would say, in the setting of COVID, a diabetic patient, no matter what the age, it is important to have a high index of suspicion. And when patients come in with facial pain and headache, screen them for mucormycosis, do a diagnostic scopy, post them for emergency surgery, and then of course institute antifungal therapy. Now we'll just go through some of the questions that are there in the chat box. I noticed that Dr. Jayanti seems to have answered all the questions pertaining to her. So has Dr. Reggie for the most part. So I would request Dr. George Verghese to actually answer a few of these questions. The first is with respect to the use of lyophilized amphotericin B. George, are you there?
Yeah, so the lipid emulsions or the lipid complex molecule, the nephrotoxicity is less. So usually about 3 to 5 milligrams per kilo is what we generally say, but each molecule is different. And therefore you may have to start with the lower dose and then titrate your way up, because some brands you see the nephrotoxicity quicker. So I would say that you would start off with 3 milligrams per kilo and then go up slowly.
Okay. The next question is about correction of anemia in patients with mucormycosis. That's a very interesting question. I hope you can sort of answer that elaborately. Yes. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So the anemia in mucormycosis, once you make sure that there is no blood loss, what we normally do is just give iron supplementation. Most of it will subside. Many are secondary to the renal disease itself. So practically, most of the time what we do is just give iron supplementation.
Okay, I think there was a doubt whether it was okay to give iron supplementation in the, you know, where you don't want to sort of give iron supplements in mucormycosis. I've seen this sort of question before. Anything that you can say about that?
Yeah, so the basic understanding of mucormycosis where there is iron overload, let's say where there is thalassemia or conditions like that, it becomes an important issue. People have looked at several iron chelating agents. Some of them actually predispose and some of them may be helpful. So the complex role of iron metabolism in mucor is not very clear. All we know is that the iron is important for the growth of the organism. but does it reflect in the iron levels in serum iron level? No, it doesn't. There is no evidence to say that the serum iron correlates with that. So, but locally, yes, there is. This is more to do with the acidity and the pH. Particularly in diabetics, the iron availability there locally is much, much more. And that's why diabetic ketoacidosis predispose them to mucormycosis. So I don't think when there is an iron, reduced iron in the body, supplementing that will worsen the mucor.
Okay. The next question is about using 5% dextrose saline, 5% dextrose for administration of amphotericin B in a diabetic.
Yeah, so we have to use, particularly when we're using the conventional amphotericin, we have to use 5% dextrose, otherwise it will precipitate in normal saline. So we should not use normal saline. When we are using 5% dextrose in a diabetic, each pint of 5% dextrose requires about 8 units of insulin. So you have to account for that additional dose. And you have to plan with it.
Yeah. The other questions are, I think, pertaining to pathology and radiology in one. So if we are having another session on that, perhaps that can be covered there. There is one case, and perhaps we can, if we have some time, we can just look at that. A patient underwent FEST twice for tissue culture proven mucormycosis with skull base osteomyelitis. After 3 months of treatment, the tissue biopsy was negative for mucor, but pseudomonas was grown. Repeat imaging showed persistent skull base osteomyelitis. 2.5 gram of liposomal amphotericin B and isavuconazole for 2.5 months now. And now there is super added pseudomonas skull base osteomyelitis. If so, how long should be treated with antibiotics? George, would you like to add anything there?
Yeah, so this first point is about the liposomal amphotericin. Hmm. Earlier, although we used to say 3 grams cumulative dose for conventional ampho, 3 or 3.5 grams, it correlates with clearance of the disease and the better outcome. It is not so with when you're using liposomal amphotericin. Like for example, if you give 10 milligrams, you can achieve that much quicker. So it is rather the duration is what generally people talk about. Anywhere between 4 to 6 weeks of IV therapy followed by the oral therapy. This is in the neutropenic host or severely immunocompromised host. So here, what they are alluding to is on repeat biopsy, there is no evidence of evidence of the organism there, but there is evidence of osteomyelitis. What we see is even at the end of 1 month of IV therapy, if you look at the images, the osteomyelitis will be evident much later. So the radiology lags behind. It does not necessarily mean that the disease is progressing. In fact, when you look at the patient, we've had several patients in our series where radiologically there is osteomyelitis on the images done at 3 months compared to baseline. There is a clear worsening of osteomyelitis. But patient is well, scopy is normal. Do you continue to give IV therapy? I don't think that is required. When there is osteomyelitis, what we have seen is they need to be continued on oral therapy, probably posaconazole or isavuconazole, whatever they are on. It takes much longer time. This is like in TB. If you have bone disease, you treat them for longer, you know, 9 months to 1 year, as opposed to when you don't have osteomyelitis. So I think we need to understand this better. To my limited understanding now is that we don't have to go back to IV therapy, but you can just continue the oral.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think that's what they're trying to say. And it looks like the adequate amount of antifungal therapy has been given. And now it's a bacterial infection. And which, you know, the, as you said, the osteomyelitic picture radiologically can persist. So I hope that answers that question. I think we can stop here. I wonder if there's any other specific question. There is one on, I think we'll stop here, because we've kind of exceeded the time. Dr. Thomas?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. And I'd like to thank all our resource faculty for this excellent, enriching, and a very engaging session, though it went beyond our scheduled time. But I think more than 500 people are still engaged in the session. So thank you, all our resource faculty, for this enriching session what we had. And also in the audience who kept the resource faculty very engaged by posting all the queries, both in the Zoom chat box and also in the YouTube chat box. We hope that this session was timely and meaningful and informative for all of you. And we have been posting on the chat box, that this there is a part two of the session planned, which is on 9th of June, 2 days from now, same time, 4 to 5 p.m. Detailed discussions by our radiology team, microbiology, and pathology team. And I think I have already shared the Zoom link and the YouTube link on the chat box. And also the session for today will get recorded. And within 24 hours or 48 hours, it will be posted on our YouTube channel of CMC COVID Pulse playlist. So keep looking out for that playlist. So I'd like to thank all of you for being in this session. And we try to bring out some topics relevant for all of you. And I saw some queries coming related to pediatric population. And we have a session planned on 14 June, same 4 to 5 p.m. on COVID-19 in children. So thank you very much, all of you. Have a safe and good evening. God bless.
Thank you.